right. Very good. Good morning, everybody. Hey, it's Clay Terrace Bible Study every Friday morning, 8 a.m. Eastern Time. And, of course, we'd love to have you zoom into our neighborhood and join us in the Bible study, no matter where you're coming in from. Some of you will even be traveling here near Christmas time, so be sure and zoom in from wherever you are. Friday mornings at 8, the details, as always, details are at clayterrace.org, clayterrace.org. And I'm a little behind on posting our videos up to YouTube, but I'll get caught up. And, yeah, you can find the videos also via clayterrace.org, or you can go to indychristian.tv. So we're in Revelation chapter 11. This morning we'll read 11 and 12. And then discuss 11. Andy Hunt is our leading pastor of the discussion and learning time together. But we have other theologians in the room and just average neighbors like myself, or below average neighbors, maybe. We're going to start off with prayer, though. So, John Carricker, if you'd do us the honors.
Well, Lord, it's a comfort to know that you have been awake all night, thinking about us, caring for us, and we do just want to pause now to turn our faces toward you and ask for your blessing once again. Would you be pleased, Lord, in this time we have together, to align our hearts and minds again to your will and purposes. And as we get into your word, Father, we think about some of the requests that have been shared. We think about this College Park family and the swimming accident, and ask God that you might encourage this family and bring healing, health, and hope. Several other requests, Lord, we lay those down before you, asking that you would encourage us by the way you cause your people to lift prayer on behalf of these friends and their expressed needs. We pray for our brother Andy now as he leads us. Ask that you would give him wisdom and open our hearts, Father, to hear from your word. For we pray this in Jesus' name and for his glory alone. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, Revelation chapter 11, verse 1. Then there was given me a measuring rod like a staff, and someone said, "Get up and measure the temple of God and the altar and those who worship in it. Leave out the court, which is outside the temple, and do not measure it, for it has been given to the nations, and they will tread underfoot the holy city for 42 months. And I will grant authority to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1260 days clothed in sackcloth. These are the two olive trees and the two lampstands that stand before the Lord of the earth.
And if anyone would harm them, fire pours from their mouth and consumes their foes. If anyone would harm them, this is how he is doomed to be killed. They have the power to shut the sky, that no rain may fall during the days of their prophesying. And they have power over the waters to turn them into blood and to strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they desire. And then they have finished, and when they have finished their testimony, the beast that rises from the bottomless pit will make war on them and conquer them and kill them. And their dead bodies will lie in the street of the great city that symbolically is called Sodom and Egypt, where their Lord was crucified. For 3.5 days, some of the peoples and tribes and languages and nations will gaze at their dead bodies and refuse to let them be placed in a tomb. And those who dwell on the earth will rejoice over them and make merry and exchange presents, because these two prophets have been a torment to those who dwell on the earth.
Eric, verse 11.
Eric?
Yes, okay. Please.
Yes. But after the 3.5 days, the breath of life from God came into them, and they stood on their feet, and great fear fell upon those who were watching them. And they heard a loud voice from heaven saying to them, "Come up here." Then they went up into heaven in the cloud, and their enemies watched them. And in that hour, there was a great earthquake, and a tenth of the city fell. 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake, and the rest were terrified and gave glory to the God of heaven. Then the second war is past. Behold, the third war is coming quickly.
The seventh angel sounded his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven which said, "The kingdom of the world has come, the kingdom of our Lord and of his Messiah, and he will reign forever and ever." And the 24 elders who were seated on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshiped God, saying, "We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, the one who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. The nations were angry, and your wrath has come. The time has come for judging the dead and for rewarding your servants, the prophets, and your people who revere your name, both great and small, for destroying those who destroy the earth." Then God's temple in heaven was open, and within his temple was seen the ark of his covenant. And there came flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, an earthquake, and a severe hailstorm.
A great sign appeared in the heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and a crown of 12 stars on her head. She was pregnant, and she cried out in labor and agony to give birth. Then another sign appeared in the heaven. There was a great fiery red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns. On his heads were 7 diadems. His tail swept away the third of the stars in the heaven and hurled them to earth. And the dragon stood in front of the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she did give birth, he might devour her child. But she gave birth to a son, a male who is going to shepherd all the nations with an iron scepter. And her child was caught up to God and to his throne. Verse 6.
Tyrone, you ready to read? Take yourself off mute.
Yeah, I was reading pretty good there. Let me see. "And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God in which she is to be nourished for 1,260 days. Now war rose in heaven, Michael and his angels fighting against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was defeated, and there was no longer any place for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who was called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. And I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, 'Now the salvation and power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brothers has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God. And they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives even unto death. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to you, O earth and sea, for the devil has come down to you in great wrath, because he knows that his time is short."
When the dragon saw that he had been thrown down to the earth, he persecuted the woman who had given birth to the male child. The woman was given two wings of a great eagle so that she could fly from the serpent's presence to her place in the wilderness, where she was nourished for a time, times, and a half a time. From his mouth a serpent spewed water like a river flowing after the woman to sweep her away with the flood. But the earth helped the woman. The earth opened its mouth and swallowed up the river that the dragon had spewed from his mouth. So the dragon was furious with the woman and went off to wage war against the rest of her offspring, those who keep the commands of God and hold firmly to the testimony about Jesus.
Chapter 8.
Amen, amen. We see here as we come back to chapter 11, even in the midst of the struggle of the church against all of the satanic empowerments of the beast, you know, God's people are still sealed from the wrath of God, as well as from those demonic forces that have been unleashed upon the earth. And John is going on to describe the church in heaven, triumphant, the church that's awaiting the great day of resurrection and judgment to come. But we come again to an interlude here between 10 and 11, where we see John speaking to the very mission of the church, which is to preach the bittersweet word, the law and the gospel to all the nations, and that the church may bear witness that the wrath of God is coming upon the whole earth. Now, we've worked our way through the most of the trumpet judgments. We're going to deal here with the seventh trumpet judgment in the next couple of weeks. It may take us 2 weeks to get through 11 here. But we recognize that the serpent is doing exactly what the serpent does. He's doing his bidding. He is deceiving. He is robbing. He is destroying. We remember what John said in John 10:10. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. So we see here that the earth's inhabitants rely not on their own righteousness, but the righteousness of God. They have rejected, most of these unbelievers, the righteousness of God, and they are not held to account, or they're being held to account now like never before, especially when this final war is about to happen. So we see there's no more time to repent. The great day of judgment is here. And those who don't believe in the Son of God will face horrible fury. Now we see something here that's interesting as well. Last week we talked about Ezekiel and about the symbolic in eating of the scroll that would give the prophet the power to preach the word of God, the covenant blessing, as well as the curse for disobedience against Israel. And like Ezekiel, what is John being called to do? He's being called to proclaim the bittersweet words of the law and the gospel, as well as this word of woe. He's declaring that God's wrath is coming upon the earth. So we've seen these two series of cyclical judgments. The seal judgments, now the trumpet judgments, are sent by God against the earth and its inhabitants. The church declares that God's word of woe will protect those who belong to him, but those who have rejected him will be called to account. Let's look here at the Revelation 1:1-2. Revelation 11, 1 through 2. Then I was given a measuring rod like a staff, and I was told, rise and measure the temple of God and the altar and those who worship there, but do not measure the court outside the temple. Leave that out, for it is given over to the nations, and they will trample the holy city for 42 months. Now, again, we always give this preface out there, and it's important. when we talk about revelations, we're speaking in apocalyptic language, and it's highly symbolic, and it cannot be interpreted literally. So we're going to see here that John has already described to us back in probably Revelation 7, when he spoke to us about the 144,000, and he spoke to us about the church in heaven, the great multitude that no one could count. Now he sees a similar scene, but this time it's in terms of the temple. And John has already told us that the church on earth suffers through this great tribulation, while the church in heaven triumphs. So now remember that there are parallels here that we must discuss between Ezekiel's prophetic ministry and what is going on in John's ministry. We see that, look at Ezekiel 40, verse 5 for just a moment. Ezekiel chapter 40, verse 5. And behold, there was a wall all around the outside of the temple area, and the length of the measuring reed in the man's hand was 6 long cubits, with each being a cubit and a hand breadth in length. So he measured the thickness of the wall, 1 reed, and the height, 1 reed. This time, we see a little difference going on here. John is commanded to do what? To measure the temple itself using the measuring rod given to him by the angel. And what really jumps out to me here is that he's not called to measure the temple. He's called to measure the worshipers in the temple. Now, we'll see later. I think it's around Revelation 21, chapter 15, where you see the temple being measured in great detail within the temple walls and everything. But here we see that John is preoccupied with making sure that those who are in the temple walls dwell in safety. And I think the symbolism is obvious, because throughout the New Testament, we see that the people of God are depicted as what? The temple of God. And they are indwelled by God's Spirit. Give you a couple of examples from the writings of Paul. Look at 1 Corinthians 3:16 for just a moment. 1 Corinthians 3:16. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? Ephesians 2:20 through 22. Ephesians 2:20 through 22. Build on the foundations of the apostles and the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you are also being built together into a dwelling place for God by his Spirit. And then I think you have to look at the Peter, 1 Peter 2, 4 through 10. As you come to him, a living stone, rejected by man, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious, you yourself, like living stones, are being built up into a spiritual house to be the holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobeyed the word, as they were destined to. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people with his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. I think it's also important to recall what John has already told us in Revelation chapter 3, verse 12. He who overcomes, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will he leave it. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which is coming down from heaven from my God, and I will also write on him my new name. So we see John, he's measuring the temple here, counting the members of the church of the church triumphant in heaven, surrounded by the altar of prayers for those suffering saints that are ascended to heaven. John does not seek to count the outer court, which is being given over to the nations, to the Gentiles. He's not to measure that. And he speaks here about the symbolic understanding of the suffering upon the earth for 42 months. And that really goes back to Daniel. It should be Daniel 9, 24 through 27. You can look that up on your own. But it's important when it speaks, it's also speaking of 42 months, which 3.5 years then, the same period is being mentioned now, that's being referred to as 1,260 days. Or I heard one of, probably King James, a time and a time, a time, a time, and a half of a time, 3.5 years. But according to Daniel, at that time, the anointed one, Jesus Christ, comes to finish the transgression and to put an end to sin, to atone for all of the wickedness, to seal up the vision of the prophecy, and to be anointed as the Most High. Look at Revelation 11 and 2 for just a moment here. Revelation 11 and 2. John sees the church triumphant here. But I want to read this because I think this is important. Look at 2 again. But do not measure the court outside the temple. Leave that out, for it is given over to the nations, for they will trample the holy city for 42 months. And go ahead to 3. And I will grant authority to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days, cloaked in sackcloth. So he shifts here from speaking about the temple to talking about these two mysterious witnesses that are going to do what? Preach the gospel to the nations at great cost to themselves. But in the end, they're going to be vindicated, and the Lord is going to lift them up. I think it's important for us to recognize that these particular two witnesses here in sackcloth and ashes, if we think about it, and we're interpreting everything from the Old Testament, there are several images from the Old Testament. We can look back and see Hezekiah, and who was the king of Nineveh, when he put on sackcloth and ashes for repentance. Look at the Isaiah 37, 1 through 2 for a moment. Isaiah 37, 1 through 2. As soon as King Hezekiah heard it, he tore his clothes and covered himself with sackcloth and went into the house of the Lord. And he sent Eliakim, who was over the household, to Shebna, the secretary, and the senior priest covered with sackcloth, to the prophet, the son of Amoz. And then Jonah 3 and 5. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They called for a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least of them. Now, when we look at these two witnesses, I think there are, you have to look at all three different interpretations of who they can be, because I think there are some real interesting contrasts here and some legitimate conclusions. You're going to fall usually within one of these three categories when we talk about these two witnesses. First, people will say these two witnesses will be Moses and Elijah. Second, those will hold that they are Enoch and Elijah. And thirdly, there are those that hold that these are two believers, unknown believers, that God has called for this specific time. Let's look at them one at a time here. Moses and Elijah are seen as possibilities as these two witnesses due to the specific miracles that John says that they will perform. Think about what he's talking about. He says the witnesses have the power to turn water into blood. That goes back to Genesis, right? Or rather, Exodus. And then we see here that the witnesses also have the power to destroy their enemies with fire. That corresponds to what? 1 Kings and Elijah. Also, given the strength of this view, Moses and Elijah both appeared with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. Remember, they were the two that came to comfort him. And also, they represented the Old Testament, the Law and the Prophets, where Jesus represents the New Covenant. So you see in that situation, you see the whole Bible, right? Okay. Then we see in further Jewish tradition, extra-biblical tradition here, we see that Moses and Elijah were both expected to return. Now, for those who hold, and I know there's just a couple here that hold this, Enoch and Elijah, and they're seen as possibilities. And you think about their unique circumstances. I think this, you know, has a ring of legitimacy to it, because surrounding their exit from the world, Enoch and Elijah are only the only two people in the whole Bible that never died. Okay? So they were taken up directly into heaven without experiencing death. Now, the proponents of this view link themselves to probably Hebrews 9 and 27, and that says that man is once appointed to die, then the judgment. Okay, they've never died. The fact that either Enoch or Elijah never experienced death seems to qualify them for the job of the two witnesses who are killed when their job, when their conquest is over, but then raised again and vindicated by God. And then the third position is the two unknowns here are two unknown witnesses for God, and that scripture, I don't see anywhere, and I search, does not identify these two witnesses by name and no well-known persons associated with their coming. But I believe that our God is perfectly capable of sending two ordinary believers and making them extraordinary and enable them to perform the same signs that we saw Moses and Elijah do. But there is nothing in Revelation 11 that requires us to assume that they had to be famous prophets from before. But what is really
Andy?
Yes.
You want to take a voice vote in here? Or is there any other candidates anybody wants to throw up other than the ones already mentioned?
Oh, okay.
Surely among 11 folks here.
You want to add to the ballot?
Yeah, yeah. You're right. We're going to add to the bottom of the ballot. Yeah. Anybody who? Who are these two witnesses? Jim Wright, you're on mute. I know you got something to say.
I think it's Billy Graham and R.C. Sproul.
There we go. All right. All right.
I would very take good. That in a heartbeat.
All right. Okay. Thanks for the break, Andy.
No problem. The interesting part here is when you try to compare this to Zechariah 4 and you start to get this understanding that Zechariah has his vision that he sees a solid gold lampstand, and on top of that solid gold lampstand is a bowl of oil, and an olive tree stands on the side. This is probably Zechariah 4 verses 3-4. The lampstand gives light that's supplied by the olive oil flowing from the trees. God's message to Zechariah was that God's work in rebuilding the temple would be accomplished not by might nor by power, but by his spirit. And that's taking you into verse 5. And like I said, this may take 2 weeks. And Jim, if you could be ready to take over half of it next week and just explain to us the whole concept and the understanding, and I'm not being dismissive, please, at all, the understanding of the rebuilding of the temple from your perspective next week.
Okay.
I think it's interesting for us to have a total understanding of the different views, and then we trust the Lord will lead us by conscience which one is correct. I mean, it's never a competition. We are all here to serve God and to learn more about him that we can give him more and more reverence.
Okie dokie, thanks.
Okay. So if we go back and look at Revelation 11 and 4, picking up on what I was just talking about from Zechariah 4, it says there, in Revelations 4 through 6 will probably be a better passage or stretch of passage to go through. There are two olive trees and two lampstands that stand before the Lord of the earth. And if anyone would harm them, fire pours from their mouths and consumes their foes. If anyone would harm them, this is how he is doomed to be killed. They have the power to shut the sky that no rain may fall during the days of their prophesying. Okay, who else had that kind of power in the Old Testament? Who else did it? Elijah, right?
Elijah.
Okay.
Yep.
And then they have the power over waters to turn into blood and to strike the earth with every kind of plague as they often desire, or as often as they desire. Who had the power to do that? Who was given the power to do that? Which would be to both of those. And that would be Moses. Okay. Just trying to go with the preponderance of the evidence, okay? And once again, we understand that this is symbolic language that is interpreted through the Old Testament. We see that Zechariah uses those same images, two olive trees that supply oil for the lampstand, to Zerubbabel, the royal figure who's gonna rebuild the temple, and Joshua, the priest that will lead the people of God in their worship of Yahweh. Like Moses, the two witnesses described by John can bring destructive plagues upon the earth. And like Elijah, they can shut up the sky. So these two witnesses here are a symbolic picture of the church on earth during the time of the tribulation. Look at Revelation 11 and 7. And when they have finished their testimony, the beast that rises from the bottomless pit will make war on them and conquer them and kill them. Now, I think this is so important to recognize that when they have finished their testimony, there are two witnesses that are offering this testimony, which is the mission that God has sent them for. They are protected and given every opportunity to strike down their foes as long as they're carrying out God's testimony. When they are finished, that is the only time that the beast is able to rise from the bottomless pit, make war on them, conquer them, and kill them. Look at Revelation 13, 5-9. I need to get there myself. Hold on a second. Revelation 13, 5-9. And the beast was given a mouth uttering haughty and blasphemous words, and it was allowed to exercise authority for 42 months. It opened its mouth to the utter blasphemes against the God and blaspheming his name and his dwelling, that is, those who dwell in heaven. Also, it was allowed to make war on the saints and to conquer them, and the authority was given it over every tribe and people and language and nation, and all who dwell on the earth will worship it. Everyone whose name has not been written before the foundation of the world in the book of life, who was slain. If anyone has ear, let him hear. So we see that the beast is being empowered by Satan, as long as that their mission, the two witnesses, are doing the preaching of the gospel, then nothing comes against them. But then they are killed. And look at 8 through 11. Revelation 11, 8 through 11. And their dead bodies will lie in the street of the great city that symbolically is called Sodom and Egypt, where their Lord was crucified for 3.5 days. Now, we've gone from 3.5 years, and then we're talking about 3.5 days. Well, 3.5 days, some from the people and the tribes and the languages and the nations will gaze at their dead bodies and refuse to let them be placed in a tomb. And those who dwell on the earth will rejoice over them and make merry and exchange presents, because the two prophets have been tormented, or the two prophets had been a torment to those who dwell on the earth. They've been a torment to those unbelievers, right? After the 3.5 days, the breath of life from God entered them, and they stood up on their feet, and great fear fell on those who saw them. What does that sound like? It comes right out of. Go ahead.
Well, go ahead and finish that if you want.
I mean, what does that illusion of that image inspire in your memory from the Old Testament? The Valley of Dry Bones, Ezekiel 37. Go ahead, Neil.
I was just going to, so obviously, as long as we were choosing candidates for two witnesses, and you said you kind of leaned into Elijah and Moses, certainly Moses died, but how do you see this passage then about both prophets dying if one of them was Elijah, who did not die?
Well, the second position, I think, and Jim, you can feel free to correct me. The second position, that is Enoch and Elijah, is more a dispensational position. I would be either with the first position or the third position, as two, you know, either with Moses and Elijah or with the two unbelievers called, not unbelievers, believers called by God to be these witnesses.
Someone say Billy Graham and R.C. Sproul both died.
Yeah, I would find it very interesting, especially later in Reverend Grant's ministry, for Sproul and him to find that much in common. Early in his ministry, yes, but as it came down, you know, you want to finish well, when it came down to the last part of that, I think R.C. would have being far to the right of him. But that's just personal conjecture.
I don't think anybody can be dogmatic on the two witnesses. I probably lean towards Elijah and Enoch, but I don't think anybody can be dogmatic on it. So,
there's some great opportunity there. So we look here. I'm excited about, or really challenged about, this city being symbolically called Sodom and Egypt. you know, again, I need to go back and look at this, but I think that is so interesting to bring up Sodom again. And again, now this is me talking out of both sides of my mouth here, but I just think it's really interesting when we look at current affairs and how we, you know, how America in its present configuration morally seems like the great Babylon. And especially when we look at Sodom and what Sodom was known for and the reason Sodom was destroyed. And then we look at the parallels in our own secular society, and there seems to be a kinship there. And this is just conjecture for me. This is not anything that I can verify in scripture, but I'm just really interested in that. That we definitely represent that great Babylon the Great, and morally, and then also when we look at the situations that are going around and being promoted and force fed to us, we are definitely going the way of Sodom, which takes us right into Peter, you know. With the same thing, says it's not going to be the flood, but a fire the next time.
So is it possible that Sodom represents sexual immorality and Egypt represents idolatry?
You know, I could live with that.
I just, off the top of my head, I have no idea.
I could live with that, because that seems to be the two major bookends that we're dealing with in this secular society. Mm-hmm. Idolatry and sexual immorality. It is absolutely mm-hmm. off the chain. I mean, I've never seen anything like it, that we are just you can't look at television. I cannot look at a commercial with my granddaughter sitting next to me without somebody, a man dressed in a leotard, trying to act like he's a girl. And I have to explain that to her.
So what's the connection to the city where our Savior died? Obviously, Jerusalem. Why are these two, Sodom and Egypt, representing Jerusalem? That's kind of odd. More than kind of.
Yeah, more than kind of.
I'm not fully getting.
Well, we're going. We can look at it two ways. Here, the context of these two witnesses point to the fact that, you know, Jesus died in Jerusalem, rejected by his people, and now in the earthly Jerusalem, it becomes a symbol of the rejection of Christ, speaking, and they're taking this as the entire city of man. Remember, we talked about St. Augustine last week, and the city of man and the city of God. So I think what John is getting at here is that the city of man, which is not the city of God, which represents the earthly Jerusalem, has rejected Jesus as well. So they stand in place of that. Babylon stands in place of the Jerusalem as the place that rejected Christ. Now, whether that, you know, I think that's what is epitomizing here. Now, look at the fact that they refused to bury the corpses for 3.5 days. Now, in the ancient world, this was the ultimate sign of contempt, to allow that body to just stay out there. Now, you remember when they would have people in, I think it probably would be Nero, he would have Christians impaled and then light them on fire as torches at night, when people could come into the city, because, you know, they didn't have IPL, so he was using this as a stepping stone to city lighting. But that was showing, it showed great derision for someone to allow them to stay out there for 3.5 days. But verse 11 says, after the 3.5 days, a breath of life from God entered them, and they stood on their feet, and terror struck those who saw them. Ezekiel 37 and 10. So I prophesied, and he commanded me, and breath entered them, and they came to light, and they stood on their feet, a vast army. So we see just as the beast appears in triumph here, God raises up his armor to continue the very witness of the church of Jesus Christ. And this, when they stand up, then they're going to reign and bring the church to reign with Jesus for 1,000 years. And 1,000 years symbolically is just eternity. But look at the verse 12 of Revelation 11. Then they heard a loud voice from heaven, excuse me. Then they heard a loud voice from heaven saying, come up here. And they went up to heaven in a cloud as their enemies watched them. Think about the fear that this would strike in the heart of an unbeliever that was just exchanging presents and frolicking and celebrating the death of these witnesses, which has tormented them for 42 months. And now they see them as they have lain out there for 3.5 days, come back to life and ascend to heaven. I mean, even if we think about the New Testament, when Jesus says, you know, if this offends you, will it offend you more when you see the man of God, the Son of God, ascend to where he was previously? If that was challenging, this would definitely have to be challenging. Would you not have to have one of those moments like the centurion that would say, surely he was the Son of God? So fear just strikes them as they see these two ascended into heaven, all those who hate Christ and reject his gospel. And when these witnesses, think about this, when these witnesses appear to be shamed and humiliated at their lowest, what happens? God vindicates them. And is this not a picture of Calvary? At the moment that Satan thinks he's had his greatest victory, we see Jesus arise from the tomb. So we see here, go to verse 13. This is interesting too, because I think it's in Matthew, you see after Jesus is risen, you have, I think Matthew's the only gospel you have the earthquakes and people who were dead walking around. But look what it says in John 11:13. And at that hour, there was a great earthquake, and a tenth of the city fell. 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake. Never stop right there. These 7,000 people have to be unbelievers. These are 7,000 unbelievers killed in the earthquake, and the rest were terrified and gave glory to the God of heaven. Now, you remember how we ended up in verse or chapter 10, everything had happened and they weren't given any glory. They were still caught up in their sin. But now there seems to be somewhat of a change of heart here. The earthquake destroys a tenth of the city, and it's, you know, clearly prefigures the sixth seal judgment that has a great earthquake associated with the return of Christ Jesus. And I think what is really interesting, again, looking at the Old Testament, John is saying 7,000 unbelievers are killed here, which are the same number of believers that remained in Israel in for Elijah back in 1 Kings 19. I just think that's very interesting. God preserved his people. He vindicated their cause, and his hand of judgment comes against those who have denied him. And then look at this almost cryptic statement in verse 14, Revelation 11, 14. The second woe has passed. Behold, the third woe is soon to come. Remember, we started off earlier, the woe, woe, Whoa. Now the end is about to come. The seventh angel is about to blow his trumpet. There are loud voices in heaven. Look at verse 15. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever. So this boastful and blasphemous city has fallen, and the new Jerusalem will take its place. The kingdom of God indeed has triumphed over all of his enemies. And unlike this city of Babylon, the kingdom of God will never have any end. Look at verses 16 through 18 as we close this up. And the 24 elders will sit on their thrones before God, as you were. And the 24 elders who sit on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worship him, saying, we give you thanks, Lord God Almighty, who is and who was, for you have taken your great power and begun to reign. The nations raged, but your wrath came, and the time for the dead will be judged, and for your rewarding your servants, the prophets and the saints, and those who fear your name, both small and great, and for destroying the destroyers of the earth. We see here that the kingdoms of this world have failed against the kingdom of our God. In verse 19, that closes up this chapter, simply says, when God's temple in heaven was opened, the Ark of the Covenant was seen within his temple. There were flashes of lightning, rumbles, peals of thunder, and an earthquake with heavy rain, or rather heavy hail. Here, the presence of the ark before the altar that was carried before the enemies of Israel when Jericho fell, I think it's a reminder that when the seventh trumpet has sounded, that the city of man, city of God, the city of man will be destroyed. The lightning here, the thunder, the great earthquake are all signs of God coming in his full glory. The full mystery of our redemption is being revealed, and God has brought everything and all things to their appointed end, because we are always on God's timetable. While the beast wars against the church, we must never forget that we who have been sealed with the name of Christ are forever saved from the wrath of God, and also from the forces of hell, that the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. That we can believe that we can be totally assured of that we can have total confidence that our God reigns, and that in the end we win, and that we will be vindicated. That getting up morning when they're lining them up, the goats on the left and the sheep on the right, and they're asking from the hostess this, smoking or non-smoking, we know we won't be in the smoking section, because our God reigns.
So that's a good point to ask the question. Hey, it's Friday at Clegg Terrace. How does this apply? What are we going to do with this? Somebody jump in. Don't make me call on you.
Well, certainly it gives you some confidence and hope about the future. I think so many of us are imprisoned by our fears about what's ahead. And, you know, if we have an ultimate hope and confidence, then I can live patiently, peacefully today.
Amen.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, we need to pass this hope on to our neighbors. How many of you think our neighbors already have an optimal understanding of Jesus, who he is, and that he cares for them. How many of you think is pretty much 100% our job is done? Anybody? Yeah, okay. So, you know, I think that's one of the applications. You know, yeah, if we have this hope, why on earth would I not try to share that with my neighbor to the degree that they're willing to hear it? As Andy said, there, you know, there's only two sections, smoking and non-smoking, right? We all want to have our neighbors with us, right? Go ahead, Bob.
Neil, this is the perfect time to use the age-old analogy that if you had a cure for cancer, would you just keep it to yourself? You know, but now we have with the vaccine coming, would you just keep it to yourself? No, you want to get it out there to the millions.
Man. Absolutely. You know when the virus started, thankfully, whoever it was in China, they very benevolently opened up the genome to the whole world to know what that was. And within, I read this week, within 2 days, Moderna had their vaccine already figured out, you know, and then it just had to get into motion. So yeah, wouldn't it be great if we could, you know, make the gospel known to everybody within 2 days? You know, it's amazing to me. So I guess from my perspective, that means we need a little less focusing on trying to worry too much about our rights and whatever else that are kind of part of our culture that easily take over our focus. And I get that. I get caught up in that too. But the more important thing is to let folks know that Jesus loves them. And because of that, we should love each other and we should love them. And in fact, we should even love our enemies. So I guess, hey, who would pray us out this morning? And as always, you get the last word if you agree to pray. Who? You may be on mute if you're trying to volunteer. Otherwise, I'm going to pray. All right. Well, I've already had the last word, so let me just pray for us. God, thank you. Thank you for putting this in black and white for us. And yes, it's interesting. It's confusing. It's any number of things. And as somebody said earlier, we wouldn't fall on our swords over our particular interpretation of some of this, but we know earlier in your book, you said we'd be blessed if we read and studied this book. And certainly we do come away being encouraged that you're the God of the universe. This is all in your hands. This is all moving toward you as the righteous King, the just King, the one that we look forward to. So thank you. Father, thanks for giving us technology so that we can still meet here, even though we don't have rolls and coffee with us necessarily. But Lord, just thank you for our time together. And yes, Lord, help us have opportunities today to pray with people, to care about them, and to share good news with them. And it's in the name of Jesus I ask this. Amen.